Thank you. Tim and Tiffany, wow. It's always fascinating to me. I was praying last night and then this morning just asking the Lord what he wanted to say. What does he want to talk about this morning? And so there's a lot of things in my mind, obviously. Lots of people I got to talk to and meet. Such a blessing. And I want you to know that when Don and I are involved in something like this, are invited into something like this, we know that it's for our benefit. Like, we never think, well, we're going to come here and really tell them something. It's always, we come to these places because there's people that God wants us to meet that move us forward. Like, that's why I don't want to leave. I want to talk to as many people as that are willing to stand here, because since we've been here, things that we're working on in other areas of our own life and work, I've met people here that advanced it, right? That's what's fascinating. And it's kind of what I wanted to talk about. And because one of the lies of the enemy all the time is that kind of self-hatred lie. Here's what the enemy is constantly saying to you and me: you're not enough. Like, you can dream all you want, it's not gonna happen, because you're too small and you're not enough, and you're not big enough for what's out there. So just stay in your little place and just forget it. That's how he talks all the time. And just being with the kids a few minutes ago, and just thinking in their minds are all these dreams and imaginations that slowly the world is gonna stomp down and trample. Like, and even we as parents contribute to it, not really knowing. I can remember our kids who are now all in their 30s and married and live all over the place. And things they would say, and you're just like, I just remember we were in grad school and we were so broke, and desperately poor. and I had come, I'm gonna talk about this a little bit more, but we had come, it was in the police department and super successful and all of that, and we had done well financially, and then God moves and we end up in grad school. And we had all the money to pay for grad school. We had plenty. We could go through grad school. I didn't have to work. We could pay it all. And, we just had all kinds of resources. And so, like a shrewd, wise person that I am, I got this financial advisor. And he, what do I do with all this money? While I'm going to spend 2 years in grad school, what am I going to do with all this money? And I don't want to. And so he said, well, put it all right in this investment. I know, see, you're groaning already. You're like, why didn't you just put it under your bed? Which I do now. And so put it all in there. I don't know, this guy's smarter than me about that kind of stuff. And this was, when was that, 87, I think. Anyway, wow. You're like, yeah, we remember 87. Yeah, we remember that year. We do too. I remember the guy that told, I will never forget the guy that told me to put it all right here, ever in my life. And so, 5 years of work and savings and all that stuff, retirement, vested retirement, all of it in one day. Gone. What? Yeah, Black Monday. Donna's reminding me. I know, I feel your pain, girl. I feel it. And so we were, I hadn't even started school yet. We hadn't even paid tuition yet. And we're sitting there looking at our checkbook, and I don't know what it was. How much was it in there? What? Donna knows exactly. $55. $55 all of everything. We had sold a house. $55 left. And so I was so mad at God. I was so mad. And I wanted Donna to be mad with me, but she wouldn't. And She's so spiritual. And I... You know how these things happen, and you have to, like, this is what people in the Bible do too, but you have to explain to God the circumstances, because he clearly doesn't seem to know what's happening. I mean, he doesn't. Like, you're like, remember us, we left this career, this promising career, and we, for you, right? For you. Yeah, I wouldn't have done it. Donna might, because she's more spiritual than I am, but I wouldn't. Anyway, and we had it all worked out, and we had everything. We didn't even need to really trust you, because we had it all. We had it all. And then you took it away. And I was so mad. And here we are. We're down here. We have two kids. I haven't even paid tuition yet, and we have 55. I had to keep telling God how much we had, because he didn't. $55, not 60, $55. And so I'm lamenting and all of that. And Donna says, let's just go spend it and get to zero and see what happens. I know. Oh my gosh. So we did. That's what we did. So we had zero. I mean, it was a great day. We spent $55. It was an amazing day. Our kids thought, what are we rich now all of a sudden? You're just buying us all kinds of stuff. And so down to zero. And I'm thinking about Tim talking about surrender. Surrender and connection, being in a community. And so those 2 years of grad school, I never worked, neither of us worked. We paid every part of the tuition on time in cash. We ate 2 years, paid rent, and to this day, I don't know how it worked. I have no idea. And then at the end of 2 years, I got hired by the University of South Carolina, and it was like manna for 2 years. I mean, the weirdest things would happen. And so, like, our kids were little, and our oldest son, Jacob, one time he said to me, Dad, because we were just praying our guts out all the time. I mean, it was like we wouldn't have food for the day. And Donna we would just pray, and God, like, just today. And it was just, I could stand here forever and tell you the weird things that happened. Me and Donna would be standing there praying, and she would turn around, and there would be $20 hanging on our refrigerator. And we would just be like, did you notice that before? And I'm like, no. Huh. Through the day, $20. There it is. It was like manna. One time we had to pay the rent. This is even later, and we had to pay the rent, and we had zero, and it was, I don't know what, $800 or something like that, and because we lived in a house where there were mushrooms growing in the bathtub. It wasn't a great house. Our kids thought, look, we have a garden, and and we don't have to go outside. And we had to pay the rent, and we came home. We were away for the weekend. We came home, and the newspaper was on the front step. And I take it in, I just drop it on the table. And when I drop it on the table, I don't know, like a $20 bill slides out from in between the pages. And I start turning the pages of the newspaper, and there's a 20, a 10, all the way through the pages of the newspaper, $850. I know. I told Donna, this is drug money. This is clearly a drug drop, and they got the wrong house. That's what this is. I know, but I don't care. I'll take Satan's money. Sure, absolutely. And launder it for the kingdom. I mean, that's what we were doing, I guess. But it was like that for 2 years. And when I got hired by the University of South Carolina, it all stopped. It was like manna. You know, manna happened until they stepped into the land, and then it stopped. And the lesson was, And you have to get this, you have to understand this. If you don't believe that God can supply all your needs, you're never gonna go forward. And it can't be like, yeah, I read a book about it. It has to be like an experiential, and God's like, I'm inviting you in to something that you would never volunteer for. And it was, we had the best time. But one time Jacob said to me, our son, he came up to me, he said, because he knew we were praying through all this stuff, you know, we were telling him all about it. And he said, I don't even remember how old he was. What was he, four? And he said, can we go to the zoo? And like, a zoo is expensive, you know? And I said, well, you know, he said, I'm going to ask Jesus if we could go to the zoo. And you're like, oh, okay, all right, whew. And so we're like, God, please get this kid to the zoo. But we couldn't afford it. We didn't have any money. And so we were, that day, one of the guys that was in grad school, a single guy, used to hang out at our house, he comes over to our house and he said, hey, you know what? Can I just take your kids to the zoo? I just would love to take them to the zoo. And Jacob, it's like normal to him. It's like, Tom's here, he wants to take you to the zoo. And Jacob's like, of course. You know, we asked Jesus and Tom's here. And so I couldn't teach my kids that, right? I couldn't, they had to learn it. And both of them, then he told his younger brother, we can just ask Jesus for stuff. And so they asked for bikes. Like they would, you know, they're immediately raising the bar. We got zoo, let's go to bike. See what happens. And somebody left bikes on our front porch. And I'm like, ask him for $1,000 right now. You got it. You're the prayer team on the family. We all have different gifts. Yours is prayer. They didn't. They wouldn't do that. They thought it was gratuitous. I like that. Like what Tim said, you cannot out-give God, and you can't out-risk God. You can't do it. You can't take a risk that's greater than what he can walk you through. But it has to be in community. Like, you can't do it just by yourself out somewhere. You need to be in community. And the guy that trained me mainly in Indonesia, he always would say, Word of God, Spirit of God, People of God. He would say it all the time to me. Word of God, Spirit of God, People of God. That's what you need. I was thinking about that and last night and this morning. And then, of course, when Tim and Tiffany get up here talking about the life groups or the connection groups, you need to be in a community. You need to be, humans were made to be in community. God has never not been in community. Father, Son, and Spirit, always community. God has never been a lonely, brooding God. He's always in a love relationship, always. God, Father, Son, and Spirit, and you. Always community like that. And the lie is that you're all alone and you're powerless. That's the lie. That's the lie. Oh, you don't have any money. You're now isolated. Nobody knows. The way we paid our tuition the first year was went out to the mailbox. And it was like, you know, of course, it's God just thinks it's funny to wait till the last minute. I don't know why. And out to the mailbox, the week it's due, you know, and there's a letter in there that went to we were in South Carolina, it went to our old address in D.C. I mean, that letter went all over the place, sent back to the guy back, he didn't know our address. He didn't even know what we were doing, the guy that sent it. And he finally makes it to our house with the mushrooms in South Carolina, and I open it up, and the guy, He said, hey, my wife and I were praying for you and Donna, and I don't know, it just feels like I wanted to send you this, and it's enough money for the tuition, right? But God wouldn't let it get there. What? You know, he wouldn't let it get there until the right time. God's all about timing. He created time, and he's about timing. He loves timing. This is what it says. This is the gospel of God, Mark. This is the gospel of God. This is what Jesus says. I'm quoting Jesus. This is the gospel of God. If you ever wonder what the gospel is, Jesus tells us. This is the gospel of God. The time has come. Timing. Timing. Trust his timing, not yours. Time. The time has come. And it's not Chronos, it's Kairos, right? There's Chronos time, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Kairos is when the divine intersects with the human Chronos. And it's so beautiful when it crashes in. Great study is to read through the Gospels using like a Greek interlinear and watching every time the word time is used in the Gospels, whether it's Chronos or Kairos. Because when it's Kairos, it means something huge is occurring. But it's in little events. So it says, at that time, Jesus went to pray. Kairos! Like this massive moment. And then there's other instances in the scripture where it says, at that time, Jesus went to pray. Chronos. Like it's just a day that you pray. But then there's a time that you need to pray. And the writers are distinguishing those times. And so Kairos moment, so I go to the mailbox at this time every day, Chronos, and on this Kairos Tuesday, something very different, something life-changing is in that mailbox. So when you're walking through Chronos time, into Chronos time, you intersect Kairos moments. And they're lined up in your future, and they don't move. They don't come toward you, walk into them, which means if you stop walking forward, they just are sitting right there, right? And here's the enemy's whole thing. Stop walking forward. That's the enemy's whole deal. And the Lord's like, come on, you don't need that bank account. Let's go. And the enemy's like, you can't go without that bank account. So now I can't go. Or you can't go. Don't drag all that property with you. We're not taking that. Like, leave it here, we're going that way, and I can't, like the rich young ruler, I can't let it go. You wanna follow me? Sell everything you have, and let's go. I can't. And so the Kairos moment for the rich young ruler is right there, and he can't walk through it. Not because he can't, he won't. Jesus walks away sad. I'm not gonna make you, I'm not gonna drag you, but if you trust that more than me, can't go. So you can just walk into those Kairos moments, and they're there until God takes you home. So you can't run out of time. It's just, okay, we're going up here, and yeah, you could have done that. Some people say that's why there's tears in heaven, you know, at the Bema Seat, you know, where the celebration feast of the believers, and Jesus is like, Bill Smith, my insurance salesman in the kingdom. And Bill Smith's like, I'm here, but I wasn't an insurance salesman in the kingdom. And Jesus like, I know you quit that job to go into full-time ministry, but I didn't ask you to do that. You did it because you felt guilty about something. But that's okay. Welcome. It's okay. And then Fred, who was a great full-time worker in Indonesia, and Fred's like, that's me, but I didn't go to Indonesia. You're like, I know. You know, I had a really good job. I know, that's a good job. But man, you would have been amazing in Indonesia. Anyway, that's okay, come on. Those are the tears in heaven. Like, oh, why didn't I go? What was I afraid of? It doesn't disqualify you, but oh man, you should have seen what was gonna happen. It's okay, all right, come on, you know, like that. It's like, I don't wanna do that in my life. So surrender and community, for sure. So this is what I want to read. Let's read Acts chapter 1. I think we have it on the slide there. I'm just 1 through 11. So I'm going to do this in two parts, just so you know. Part 1, and then part 2 later. So, yeah, I'm sorry to disappoint you. But you'll see why I'm doing that. Okay, so let's read it. I'm reading from the ESV, Acts chapter 1. In the first book, O Theophilus, so this is Luke writing, to Theophilus, Luke the historian. In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit. Notice that Jesus speaks through the Holy Spirit. That's Word of God, Spirit of God, people of God. Even Jesus in his humanity speaking through the Spirit. Until the day he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen, he presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days. Okay, now I want you to pay attention to this sentence. Luke's emphasizing this. When Jesus is in his last 40 days with his people, there's one topic he wants them to get. If Christ, he's going to ascend in 40 days, and this is one thing I want you to understand, and it's this is the gospel of God that starts in Mark. The time has come, the kingdom is at hand. That's the beginning of his incarnational talk, and it's the ending of his talk. It's also the beginning of the Bible. And the end of the Bible, the meta-narrative of all of Scripture is kingdom of God. He presented himself alive after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking to them about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Okay, what's interesting also about this is, if right then, if we would have said, ask the disciples, I just love the disciples so much. It's just like your friends at Big Lots or somewhere, you know, it's just like, what are you guys waiting for? We're waiting for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. What is that? We don't know. Well, what's it going to look like? We don't know. Like, we're not sure what it is. Didn't Jesus tell you what it is? No, he said, wait for it. What do you think they thought it was? If you ask Jesus, what is the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Was he like, oh, you'll know. Trust me, you'll know. Yeah, but how will we know? You will know. But he doesn't explain it to them. Isn't that interesting? I can't go unless I know. Then you're not going. Like, it's a mystery. It's not about certainty and formula and prediction and expectation. It's about mystery and faith. Just wait. I'm gonna surprise you with this one. So that's his promise. Wait for the Spirit. Not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, because this is, they're a little confused on this point. So will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? See, they don't get what the kingdom is. You mean like a political, geographic kingdom that's going to be Israel? No. And he says to them, that's not for you to know. Think how consumed we are with knowing those things. We're consumed with knowing the end times. They're asking him about it right here, and here's what he said. It's, what's that next word? Not for you to know. It's a mystery. You wouldn't get it if it happened. You won't understand it. You'll think about it. It's not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. That's not what's important. Here's what is important. Don't get all hooked up on what the end looks like and when it's coming. Don't get into that. Here's what you need to think about. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my experts in eschatology. No. Unimportant. The Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses. That's what's important. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria, the place you never go, Samaria. These are all places that Jesus did go, and to the ends of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, can't you see him? They're like, where'd he go? And while they were gazing into heaven, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, why are you looking up at the heaven? Like, why are you guys distracted by this? Like, that's where he went is actually not all that important either. This Jesus who was taken up from you in heaven will come in the same way as you've seen him go into heaven. So here's, don't focus on that. Hello, hello, hello. Here, don't, he's coming back. That's okay. Don't worry about when he's coming back and when the end is. Don't worry about that. Here's what you need to do. You need to wait until the Holy Spirit comes upon you and then get about it. Get going on what? Being witnesses in the whole world. That's what you need to think about. And like, it's interesting in Christendom, when you're, you know, sort of like talking, it's like Christians are more interested where Jesus went and when the end is than being witnesses. And the enemy's really good at distracting us into everything about the Gospels except lifting Jesus up as witnesses. Because it's way easier to sit at home and try and figure out the end times than to go live in a country where they want to kill you if you're a believer. Right? So, you can't out surrender. You can't outgive God. So we're to be his witnesses. And the, you know, the Greek word witness is martyr. Not a great word, you know, not a big invitation. You will be my martyrs in Jerusalem, Judea. But you'll be my witnesses. And so, like we said the other day, witnesses are just, what did you see and experience with God? Say it. Which means you need to experience something with God first, in order that you have something to say. Otherwise, you're just giving information to people, which, and information doesn't transform people. It doesn't. God transforms people. Experiential encounter with the living God transforms people. So, witnesses. So, for Donna and I, you know, we got married in 1983, and Donna was telling this last night to some people. When I first met her, I had no idea that she was Jewish. I had never met a Jewish person. I'm from Washington, D.C. I had never met a Jewish person. And so when she was introduced to me, when we were 19, she was introduced to me and my roommate. This guy brought her over and introduced her to us. Because the guy that she had been dating had come to faith, and he wanted her to hear the good news. So he brought her to me and my roommate, and then he left. So the first thing I said to Donna, because it's all I really knew how to do in sharing the good news, was I told her that she... I said, you know, hi, nice to meet you. God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. And she's like, what? And I said, however, that's good news, except, however, you are sinful and separated from God, which the penalty of that is hell. That's my opening. If you're interested in a person, maybe for their future, do not, that's not the way to start. But anyway, that's what I did. And she said, hold on. Did you just tell me I'm going to hell? And I'm like, well, yes. And then she told me where to go. And which was, I've never had that response before. And then she said, I'm Jewish. We're the chosen people. We don't need the crutch Jesus that you guys need. And I was like, you're Jewish? Yes. So when I was going to be a witness, see, I wasn't being a witness. I was just firing information at her. That's all I was doing with no personal anything. And she didn't respond to that. And so then I like had to like adjust, pivot. So my prayer to God was, because that was all I had. I had one presentation. When that didn't work, I had nothing else. Nothing else to say. Couldn't go to point two because point one got jammed down my throat. So point two didn't make any. And so I said to God, do you know how to talk to a Jewish person? Do you know how to present Jesus to a Jewish person? Like, this is how, I feel like God always is looking at me going, what are you talking about? Have you not read the Bible? Like, what's wrong with you? They're all Jewish. Like, well, but my grandmother told me that Abraham was the first Christian. She did. Wasn't Abraham a Christian? Like, where did Donna come from? Like, where? Anyway, so I started thinking, oh, well, you know, she's Jewish, so let's talk about the Old Testament. And so then we started, she was ready to go. And I said, wait a second, hold on. You know, there's some beautiful passages in the Old Testament. And then her and I and my roommate together dove into the Old Testament together. And then she was able to ask me questions that she just had always wondered about but didn't feel like she could ever ask anyone. And so far into the night, just the Spirit of God just really moved. Not only in her, in me. And what's so interesting thinking about this, we've been married for 40 years, is that even when we first met, the one thing God was trying to teach me and her was that that identity is important to people. You can't just force identity on people. And Donna, when she left, she said, she was crying. She left and she said, I know that what you said, she told me later, is true about Christ and all of that, but I cannot betray my Judaism, my Jewish heritage, and my grandparents who survived, you know, the pogroms and Holocaust, and betray them by becoming a Christian. I can't, even though I know it's true. I didn't know that Jesus never asked anyone to be a Christian. Have you noticed that? Because he wasn't interested in switching from one religious system to another. He was interested in spiritual transformation. And I thought it was about switching teams. I thought that was the goal. Conversion, convert them. And Jesus says, he says in the Gospels, he says to the Pharisees, you're converting, is the word he uses, you're converting Greeks, Gentiles, into Judaism and making them twice the sons of Satan than you are. That's not a light statement. That's what he says about conversion, but he never says that about transformation. Right? Way later on, when just not all that long ago, a young Muslim guy came to faith in this, I'll talk about it some other time, but young, he'd only been a believer about a year, and he had been incarcerated for talking about Jesus. And then he was released because Jesus was in the cell with them, and he led his cellmate to faith, and they started singing. It was like in the Bible or something. And the police were like, shut up, because you're making this place joyful. And they released him to shut him up. He's like, oh, we have a strategy here. Joy, right? But then he gets arrested by the secret police, and they torture him for 5 days, cutting him with razor blades and wrapping him in plastic to dehydrate him, and then hanging him up and cutting him at night. And they're cutting him, and because he had had a personal encounter with Christ in a hotel room, he didn't convert from this to this. Conversion doesn't stand up under torture. Transformation does. Personal experience. It wasn't Jamie talked me into this. When you cut with a razor blade, that goes away fast. So this is what so they were cutting him. They had been cutting him for 4 days. And they said, you need to renounce that you're a Christian. And he didn't know what they meant because he'd only read the Gospels. He'd never heard the word Christian before other than that tribe over there are Christian, a Christian tribe. So he's like, when they said, you can't be a Christian, he would think, oh, how can I be a member of that tribe? You have to be born into that tribe. I'm from a Muslim tribe. I'm not a Christian. I'm a Muslim. I don't know what you're saying. And then they couldn't figure it out because this guy's walking around leading people to Christ. And so the guards were confused. And they had a conference and they're like, okay, we've been cutting him for 4 days. He is not a Christian. But why is he talking about Jesus all the time? And so they said, they go back to him and they say to him, okay, you can't talk about Jesus anymore. And he said, oh. He said, how can I not talk about the one who is talking to me every time you cut me? How do I deny someone that's true? Like, it's impossible. He's bleeding from the cuts. And they're like, he's talking to you? And he said, yeah, every time you cut me, this kid is 22 years old. He's been a believer for a little more than a year. I think, what would an American 22-year-old do in this situation that grew up in the church, maybe? They said, what's he saying to you? And he said, every time you cut me, I can hear him talking in my ear, and he's saying, I'm inside your pain. And so when you cut me, he comes out through the pain. It's like I'm filling up his suffering. He hasn't read the writings of Paul yet. He's living them. Later, when he read them, he's like, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, there it is. Paul knows it, gets it. Right? And so he said, and they were like stunned. And they realized that as they cut him, his joy was getting deeper. This is how when you read about people dying in the Colosseum, watching their kids being eaten by lions, they're singing. These people didn't convert, they were transformed. Like, it's unbelievable. And so he said to the guards, he said, but listen, I asked Jesus if he would move around so I could look in his eyes. And Jesus said to me, to do that, I would have to take you home. And so he said to the jailers, will you just cut my throat so I can see him? Please, I'm asking you to kill me. I want to see him. I don't want to just hear him. I want to see him. Would you kill me? And they're like, no. We're releasing you. And he's like, shoot. Do you know why? Because to live is Christ. It's hard. To die, though, is gain. So they released him. That guy he understands death the way we don't. He understands death the way Jesus talks about it. There is no death. Do you believe that? If you did, nothing would stop us. We wouldn't have to self-protect. We wouldn't have to protect my life at all costs. It'd be a disappointment that we got to stay alive. You mean we can't go? We can't go. So Donna and I, so we worked through that, and you know, we obviously got married and began our life together in the police department, and she's a teacher, and Donna really wanted to go out into the world. Once she understood Christ and embraced Jesus, which had nothing to do with me at all, trust me, I did everything I could to hinder that process, but she met Christ, and she lived in a different city than me, and she called me one night, and she said, I'm in, I've decided. I'm embracing Christ. And she had to do it inside the Jewish community. She had to be in the Jewish community and make the decision inside the Jewish community among her people to decide, I'm going to be a follower of Jesus. Not over with the Christian community, inside the Jewish community. And it was in there that Jesus really met her among her people. And the Lord was teaching us a lesson about when we would live in the Muslim world. Because that was going to be the challenge. And so... So we got married and we're living the dream, and then I had this interview with the State Department, and I knew that Donna was always like going forward at missions conferences and stuff. I never went. She would go, I'll go for you. And 5 years she went forward by herself. And I said, when the Lord calls me, he'll call me the way he calls me, not the way he calls you. Right? The Lord knows you. He made you. He will invite you the way he invites you, not the way some other thing invites you. You'll know. How do you know what the Spirit is when it comes? You'll know. How do you know when God invites you to go live in another country? You'll know. You'll know. You don't have to have someone force you into it. You'll know. But you got to be listening. And so when the State Department interviews me and I'm sitting there talking to this guy, I know this is God's invitation. Here we go. This is where he invites me into life. He invites me in a movie theater to walk with him, and then he invites me in an interview with a State Department official. We're going overseas. Donna hears it in the church. I hear it in an interview. Isn't that beautiful? Because he loves each one of you, and you each have your own identity. So forward, so we go. That gets us through that whole process into grad school, broke, out of grad school, working in university, get hired by the Ministry of Education in Indonesia, and here we go. And we get all the way over there for our first years in Indonesia on this little tiny island where I'm working at an Islamic university, which is an interesting position. And they hadn't ever had a foreign professor there, and we were some of the very few foreigners that lived on this completely Islamic island, pretty radical island. And so we go into that life and teaching in the university and totally don't, like we thought we could just talk them into it. Like we didn't really understand the experiential hearing from God identity part yet. It was built into us, but we didn't understand it yet. So we go in there and we do what we learned how to do in a seminary class. And so I'm teaching in an Islamic university with grad students. I'm a foreigner, I'm a Christian, and I basically what I tell them is everything you believe is wrong. It's a lie. The person that you revere, the prophet that you revere is not a prophet, he's a pedophile and a terrorist. How do you think this is going to go over? How do you think this is going to go over? This is what Christians say about the Muslim world all the time. But I'm here to tell you the truth because I'm the expert, and so I'm having a thing at my house. Would love you to come. Oh, they came. But not to sit down and go, oh, please lead us. They were, it hurt them. It made it infuriated. Can you imagine going, a Muslim coming into a Christian seminary and standing up and saying, the Bible you believe is a lie? That's basically what I was doing to them. How insulting that is to them and hurtful. Like, who are you? Oh, I'm here because God sent me. Like that. And so we continued in that rough way. And eventually I got arrested. Huh. Not because I was filling up the joy of Christ in my suffering, because I was insulting people every day. And I got arrested. And they told me, you're under arrest. You can't leave this island. Donna can't leave. Your kids can't leave. Nobody can leave. And you're on trial. And the penalty for what you have done is 10 years in prison here. And you are not allowed to speak because only Muslims can speak in a court. And this is your trial date. We'll see you then. And trust me, you have no friends here that are going to stand up with you because you've insulted everybody. So we'll see you on that day. So I come home and I tell Donna, and what do you do? So we're 10,000 miles away from anyone we know. There's no, before the internet and all that stuff, nobody's rallying to our defense. I have to call the State Department and tell them what happened. I call them like, hey, just so you know, so you can send a SEAL team in here to get us out. I did this, and they're like, well, did you say the things they said you said? And I'm like, well, yeah. And they're like, good luck. Thank you for your service. Click. So we're all alone. And the enemy's like, I'm going to kill you here. I'm going to destroy. And when you go to prison for 10 years, your Jewish wife on this militant Muslim island with your kids is going to have to learn how to live for 10 years alone. See how horrifying that thought is? I was like, God, what do you want me to know? What do you want me to do? And so I go to the trial, on the trial date, and there's three Islamic clerics, and the head of the university, and the dean that brought the charges against me, and they read the charges, and I'm like sitting there, and I'm thinking, gosh, everything they're reading, I did. It's not like they're trumping up any charges or lying. They're saying exactly what I said, and I'm embarrassed by it. I feel ashamed. And I said to God, I'm sorry I did that. It's like I didn't even ask you what to say to them. I just thought I was better than them, and I'm sorry that I did that. And I'm pretty sure I can survive 10 years in prison here, but I'm worried about my family being alone and unprotected. Me telling God that my family's unprotected. Then I said, so just help me to learn this lesson as we go forward. And just, God, just take me through it. And the judge, the clerics say, you know, okay, you violated this statute and it's 10 years, hard labor. And does anyone want to speak on this guy's behalf? And it's like, dead silent. And then all of a sudden, the door opens behind me in the room, and this guy comes walking in, and he's a Muslim for sure, because he's dressed in the uniform of a professor, and he walks in, and he walks to the front of the courtroom, and I've never seen him before, I don't know who he is, and he says to the clerics, he said, yeah, I would like to say something, which means he is a Muslim, because he wouldn't have been allowed to speak. And he says, you all know who I am, and they all know who he is, and I have no idea who he is. And he said, I'd like to say something on behalf of this guy. And I'm like, who are you? And he said, I just want to say a short story, and then I'll leave you to decide what you want to do with him. But he said, I just finished my PhD at Arizona State University in pure linguistics. And they're all like, yeah. And they're like, that's a super prestigious statement in this small Islamic university who's never sent anyone anywhere. And here's this guy, whoever he is. I know he's not from here because I know everyone in the university, and he is not from here. And so he says, I went to Arizona State University, me and my wife. I was sent there by the government of Indonesia because, you know, on a scholarship, and I got into the program, and I realized that I was going to fail the program because I just couldn't handle the English language. And so I knew that if I failed the program, that when I came back to Indonesia, because I shamed the country, I would never be employed again. So it was just a complete disaster. Now, for a Muslim to say this in public, in an open public forum like this, they would never do. So I'm thinking, okay, I know this guy's a Muslim, but he's not a normal Muslim, because they would never tell the truth like that. They would never dishonor themselves publicly like that, but he's doing it. Something is different about this guy. What is different about him? But he's a Muslim, I know, because these court people respect him. He just walked in. He has some kind of wasta, they called it, power, like authority to do this. Who is he? And he continues. He goes, so me and my wife sat on the bed in our little dorm room and cried because we were going to fail. And then there was a knock at our door, and there were these two students there, grad students in the same program, and they said, we're here to help you. They're Americans, he said. They're Americans, and they said, this program's really hard even for us, but we feel like we're here to help you succeed. So whatever you need in any way, our wives will help your wife. Anything we can do to help you, we will. And he said, these two Americans were never too tired. They always helped me anytime I called them. They did whatever I needed. And he said, after like 2 or 3 months of being friends with them, they invited me to a meeting on Wednesday nights. And I'm like, you're kidding. Are you going to say this? Because now I think I know. And the Muslim guy says, so I went to the meeting, and it was a Bible study. And I went to that Bible study every Wednesday night for 3 years. He said, now does anyone in here think, because I went to a Bible study with these Christian guys for 3 years, that I'm not a good Muslim? Anybody think that? And he points to the dean that accused me. Do you think that? Are you calling me not a good Muslim? And the guy's like, no, oh, no, no, you're a good Muslim. You're a good Muslim. All the way across. Anybody say that about me? No. Okay, he said, so here's my question, and then I'll let you decide what you're going to do with this guy, because I don't know him. But I want to know, if we're the great religion, Islam is the great religion and the final revelation, he said, and the Christians are less than that, they're great, they're good, but they're less than that. I go to their country, a Christian country, and these Christian guys come to help me, and I graduated above both of them because they lifted me above themselves in the program. He said, and they're of the lesser religion. In fact, they might consider me as a Muslim their enemy. They loved me, and they sacrificed on my behalf. He said, now we have this guy here. He's come to our country, and he said things he shouldn't have said. He said, but as the greater religion, when the lesser religion sacrificed for me, are we going to put this guy in jail? I mean, is that the right thing for the greater religion to do? Just because he made a mistake? I don't think that's right. Thank you very much. Do what you want with him. And he left. And I'm like, oh my gosh, who is that? And the cleric says, I think we need to release this guy right now. And there we find you not guilty. You're free to go. And I walk out of the room and I walk outside and I'm thinking, that was an angel. It was an angel. Except he was smoking, standing outside smoking. And I'm like, nah, I don't think so. And I walked up to him. Now, remember, this is part one. I walk up to him and I go, who are you? And he said, did you see who was sitting up front there? And I said, yeah. He goes, did you notice the empty chair? Yes. He goes, you know who was supposed to be in that chair? And I said, I think the head of the Islamic Association of all of Indonesia. And he said, that's right. Do you know why he wasn't there? No, he was killed yesterday in a car accident. I'm the new one. This is my first day. And he flew from Jakarta out to this little island. I flew out here when I read what was happening to you to thank my two friends at Arizona State University that rescued me. He said, trust me, I did not come here because of you. He said, now listen, I know you're here because you believe Jesus sent you here to talk to Muslims about Christ. He said, that's fine, but you better find another way to say it because you're hurting my feelings when you talk. So when you talk about Jesus, talk with the kind of love that those two guys talked to me and say it a different way. And I have never forgot that lesson. And when they released me and we stayed on that island 3 more years, this is what Jesus kept saying to me. When you talk to people about me, you say it the way I tell you to say it. And you say it with love and grace. And you better learn to say it a different way. Father, thank you for the guy, Husni is his name, who came that day. Thank you for Husni, Lord. God bless him and his family. Thank you for the two students at Arizona State University that saved my life. They were your witnesses, Lord, that reached 10,000 miles away and saved my family. And Lord, make us your witnesses. Make us your witnesses when the Spirit comes upon us as we wait for the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Make us your witnesses. In Jesus' name, I pray. So I will tell you what happened after that.